Good morning. We're so happy to see you all here today. Praise the Lord. What good music. The choir, how wonderful song. We appreciate that. The message today. The whole story. The beginning. An old story. The death, the burial, and the resurrection.
Why would God be happy when a Christian dies?
come to be with him, and he's happy that he's joined with us. He's not sad in the death. When one is lost and goes to hell, he doesn't have Jesus' heart. He's there forever. But God rejoices with us when we're saved. He rejoices when he comes with us, when he can walk with us in strength and in power. You know the way. You know all around us. When we see the glory, the song, we can see the glory of God. So as we continue talking about the resurrection, it's proof of our salvation. God has planned it all. It's there. It's proof. The empty tomb is there, showing us his plan, his perfection. The Bible talks about the resurrection. But it really is speaking of the physical, not spiritual. Our spirit goes on forever, but the body will die. So the Bible speaks of the physical resurrection and how it applies to us physically, not to us spiritually. The second thing we have, the second verse, now, in the Greek language, what language was used there? What language was the New Testament? Resurrection means to stand up. Something that was dead to stand up. We see the miracle of that because that's not physically possible. But we see here Jesus was raised again and will come for us again. As some of the churches had wrong teaching, we see Paul as he is writing to this specific church in Corinth. There weren't a lot of people in that city. The church was established. Where? Was it in Israel? Jerusalem. And it spread from there. And the people there in the city of Corinth, they believed many different things. And Paul arrived. And he had some there in that area that believed in other false gods, as well as those who were Christians with him. So the teachings in that area that they believed, okay. But in the area where people believed different things that were wrong, first of all, that those who die would go into this place, they would die and they would become a god. And that universe of God is a wrong thought. It's a wrong thing to believe. A second thing was believed there that there was nothing after life. The third was the concept of reincarnation, that you die physically. The spirit goes on and comes back again and again and again. Get better each time when you work, but maybe you come back as a cow or something else. Some wrong ideas there. But people have believed, for the people in that area, they've been saved, but those wrong teachings were coming in. We see Paul wrote many books in the New Testament. Because he was there not being critical, but showing these churches the right thing. The right things to be in our church. And he was very clear in that. He said, Paul wrote this book to the Corinthians. We see here, and he is correcting them about the reality and the truth of the resurrection. How do we get from here to eternity only through Jesus and his death? his burial, and his resurrection. That's the gospel. It's the good news that Jesus died, that he was buried, and that he was raised again and ascended to heaven. Amen. But when you experience that, that resurrection, will you be resurrected as well? Yes. When you ask Jesus into your heart. Because he knows. He knows that you'll be there when we accept Jesus. We know that faith is important. We have to have faith in Jesus. But to put our faith in the right things, not believe the wrong things. No, I have faith, I have faith, I have faith. But it has to be in the right way. Faith in the church, does that mean we're going to heaven? No. Faith in your pastor, do you follow your pastor when you get to heaven? No. We have to have the right faith. Oh, I can make my way to heaven on my own. Can you do that? No. You must believe in Jesus. Not just Jesus. But that Jesus is raised again. That he died and was raised again. Will that save you? No. He's dead and buried. But he raised again. And that's what it is that we need. The power of God through the Holy Spirit. And through that we can have eternal life. We look at 1 Corinthians chapter 15. It represents for us the greatest event in all proof that he came for us, that we are saved through him. You see here, 1 Corinthians 15, 1, 2. Moreover, brother, I declare to you the gospel which I preach to you, which you also receive, which you stand, by which you also are saved. You hold fast to that word which I preached to you, unless you believe that Jesus can save you, not depending on the church or the pastor or anything else or somebody else, but the resurrection of Jesus, that is it. And Paul preached that gospel to them in the city of Corinth. They accepted that. They received it. And they were saved. Yet some people there were thinking, oh, no, resurrection. No, that can't be. So Paul was there writing and encouraging them to see the resurrected Savior. There's an old song that says, I serve a risen Savior. What kind of a Savior? A dead Savior? A sleeping Savior? Tired? No. A risen Savior. That spirit we can have. There is no other Savior. He lives today. He lives today. I know he lives today. He talks with me once in a long life's narrow way. He lives. He's risen. Paul continued here in verses 3 and 4. For I delivered to you, first of all, that which I also received, that Christ died for our sins, in our place. We go here and we can tie this to the scripture. That Jesus was buried and that he was risen again on the third day. to risen Savior, Jesus Christ, we can see the relationship we have here. And our activities need to match what we have here to fit this, that we have Jesus as our Savior. And Paul was there in Corinth. There was no New Testament there. And he used the Old Testament to share with them and apply to them the message of Jesus Christ. What's the first thing? That he died. That he was buried. And that he was raised and ascended.
So late because the sun
sun was going down. They went and they placed him in the tomb. And there were the soldiers guarding the tomb. Proof enough, Jesus was there. And he was raised again on the third day. Not ascended again, but raised. On the 40th day, he ascended to heaven. Yeah, we see how it fits with the scriptures. Everything, Jesus rose. He rose from the dead. We see it comes together with the scripture. Perfect. You know, we need to understand. If you're saved, you believe the gospel, that he died, that he was buried, that he was raised. There's so many things that don't believe that. They're seeking help. There are many people who doubt that Jesus was raised. But there were so many people that saw him. We see here that many people saw him. Without the cameras, without anything, they saw him right there. We see Peter saw him. The 12 disciples saw him. Did that include Judas? Why? Where was Judas? He was already gone. He was not there. But the 12. And 500 others with Jesus after he was raised again. James was there, the half-brother of Jesus. All of the apostles saw. Paul himself saw Jesus. Saw him raised. Not dead, not buried, but raised. A Savior. And then Paul wrote of himself. In chapter 15, verses 9 and 10. Paul saying, I am the least of the apostles who am not worthy to be called apostles. But because of the persecution of the church of God, by the grace of God, I am what I am. His grace was not in vain. For I labored more abundantly than they all. Yet, not I, but the grace of God, which was with me. Not my work. We see the change of God. They persecuted him, they struck him, yet he was risen again. We see here, wow. The Christians, they wanted to take them, they were persecuted. Paul was there, he hated the church. He hated the Christians. He wanted them to stop that. False teaching thought. And he was there persecuting the church in such a horrible way, trying to destroy it. Paul wanted to destroy the church as the enemy of God. Yet, when he was on the road, he came face to face with God and his glory. And he could see what kind of a Jesus. He met a resurrected Jesus. Wow, he was changed forever. And when we meet the resurrected Jesus, we are changed forever. Not the same, but different. To meet the resurrected Jesus has come, and he will save us through these three things. And you know this story. Jesus was there with the Pharisees' home. Having a meal, the woman came in, saw Jesus there, and she wept great tears. And they came on Jesus, and then she wiped and anointed his feet with oil. The Pharisees were going, wow, he's not a prophet. Who is this woman? What is she doing? Oh, it's horrible. But Jesus knew their thoughts. Jesus knew their mind. And he asked them, Jesus said, the man had someone who owed him money. He owed him a great deal of money. And another one owed him a little. They came. Who would love him more if he was forgiven? The Pharisee said, well, I guess the one who owed much. Because he loved much. The one who owed little would love him. But Jesus says, maybe. Maybe you're right. But when you enter your home, you wash your feet. No, but this woman came in here. She was there. She washed my feet. And she used her hand. She said, your sins are forgiven to her. And she went away. And the point of this story, the woman was a sinner. And she realized that there was God. She came before him. God, Jesus forgave her sins because she was willing to cleanse it. She served. How amazing that is. There in that moment, they were not willing to serve. They did not serve God at all. We see the relationship between forgiveness. The woman experienced forgiveness in a great way. And she loved Jesus in a great way. The Pharisees were forgiven for nothing. And they did not love it. It's good for us to realize that when Jesus died on the cross, he was buried in the tomb, and he was raised again. And he was there, we remember. For us, all of us, for all of our sins, showing his love for us, his mercy for us, his grace for us. And we need to show that same thing, that love for him, of how to serve. If God forgives much, then we need to serve much in the same way. Chapter 15, verse 1. Again, written to the church in Corinth. Therefore, whether it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believe. If you deny the resurrection, the power of God, then God's plan for all people, his plan in all of history, proves the resurrection of Jesus Christ. How do we know it? But how do we know it? Does it hit us? Are we inspired by it? Do we still serve him? Do we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ? And that he will save us? But in all these things, to believe that he died. Does that not save us? To believe that he died and was buried, does that save us? But if we believe that he died, that he was buried and then raised again, wow, now that is what we accept. If we believe that, the power of God will change us from corrupt sinners to Christians filled with the Spirit, ready to be with God, with the promise of eternity, to be there with him. What's the proof? The resurrection of Jesus. So it's important that all of the these things in the gospel. Death, burial, and the resurrection. So, if there is no resurrection, what that means, there's no gospel, there's no good news, there is no salvation, there is no Savior, and there is no heaven. But what that means is that we're dead. But yet, we can have faith that after death, we will be with Him, that Jesus Christ, who was raised again, paid in full our sins, the debt that we have. How? By accepting Him, by serving Him, that He's forgiven us. We can say that we love God in an awesome way, and when we think about, you love me, what will you do? My commandments, right? If we love God, then we will do. We will serve. We'll not just sit back and show nothing. We must love God and serve Him because we are all sinners. Guess what? He's gone. He's not here. The tomb is empty. And that is the proof that He's alive. We can say Happy Easter because He is risen. Every Sunday we can say Happy Easter. But I want to ask you today, have you experienced the forgiveness and salvation of Jesus? Do you believe? How much do you love Him? Does it burn within you like a fire? Or is it just a small flicker, a tiny little thing that you hide? Is it a fire? What is it? If you love God with that fire, you'll serve Him. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, today, our prayer is that if you feel down, today is the day to make that decision for Jesus Christ. To come, to become that fire within us. As we have this time of invitation, as you consider what it is that God has for you, we'll come and we'll have Cynthia lead us in a song. Our ministry leadership team will be around this room.